We are all engineers over here, students and professionals. In the contemporary world, the engineering that's happening over there, or what you will be doing after getting out of the colleges, it's all about efficiency improvement. All the engineering is towards efficiency improvement, whether in the sector of energy, waste management, water, everywhere. And that's what the green building is all about. So our next speaker is Mr. Ashish Jain. Good afternoon, everyone. So inspiring to see all the youth and all the elders giving so much of inspiration to us. Thank you, sir, for that. And I was just thinking about, you know, what should I cover in my presentation today for you guys, because you actually need to know and take something back home, as in what did you learn out of the whole session today and what should be the takeaway. So I thought, let me start with very few, you know, slides on some of the basic concepts that we have for the green buildings and take you through some of the project examples that we have. So I would like to start with this question, what is a green building? Because, you know, this question needs to be answered properly by each one of you when you go out of this hall, when you talk to your friends, talk to your, you know, family members. You need to understand what it is all about. And there are many definitions available for green buildings or sustainable buildings that you will find on Google or other internet searches. Let me tell you, this is a green building. Do you agree? Yes? People used to ask us when we started this green movement, you know, way back in 2003 or 2004, that is it a building painted with green color is a green building? Of course it's not. To me, the simplest definition that I can put forward to you is that a green building is nothing else but a building which is good for our health, for our wallet, and for our planet. This is what the whole green building concept is all about. And it is a win-win situation for each one of us and for the environment as a whole. As Dr. Jain already mentioned in his talk, it was a movement which was started in 2001 by IGBC. Since then, the movement has been grown exponentially and it has been adopted by all the stakeholders that are involved in the building industry. It has been adopted for all types of buildings, all scale of buildings, all consultants, all architects, and it has been accepted very well. And today, you know, we take pride of being standing at, you know, that kind of an area of green footprint that we have for our country. 5 billion square feet is a very good number, and the target set for ourselves by Dr. Jain is already, you know, so motivational that we have to go for that. The another question that we came to, you know, encounter many a times is that why do we need green buildings? Is it something new to us in a country like India? Green buildings are new to us? Of course not. India is a country with a very rich heritage. We have our traditional buildings standing tall even today after hundreds of years, which are not only sustainable or energy efficient, but also very comfortable for people who are visiting those even today. So those are live examples. There was some magic. What was that magic? We talked about it earlier, but you know, some of the features which are the whole architecture was revolving around nature, and the building features which make those buildings sustainable and comfortable included some of these. You will see when you visit any one of these buildings, courtyard planning, jalis, jarokhas, you know, the building surrounded with water. These are all passive measures which make, you know, these buildings more sustainable and comfortable. Of course, we are in a transition phase. Our needs have changed. We no longer can make monuments with a 2 foot thick wall, which can, you know, keep the building free of heat gains. We have a transition going on, and there had been, you know, from joint families to nuclear families, a huge shift. space constraints are there. From Havelis, we have moved to flats now. One Haveli or one, you know, bungalow getting converted into multiple family houses, which can put a lot of pressure on the resources that are available. From shopping streets, we are moving to malls. A whole set of new requirements, a different set of requirements that we have to deal with. Building materials have also been transformed from stone to a lot of concrete. We had jharokas earlier, now we have balconies. Facade treatment, the kind of materials used to be done earlier, there was no use of glass at all. But we have quite extensive glass today. Is it really good or bad is a different subject, but this is something that we have to deal with. There was no electricity earlier, but today we have the electricity, we have to use it, but in a right manner. So we know the challenges which are being faced today, a lot of burden on the roads when you go out. You will see situations like these, which are absolutely not desirable for anyone. We have, as Dr. Sharma was mentioning, you know, a few days ago, we had a situation when it was instructed not to go out of home. So, of course, our outdoor, you know, situation is not very good. So, what do we do? Today, we need to just change our approach. The way we think about our buildings, the way we design our building, we construct our building, have to change. And as rightly said by Albert Einstein also, we can't solve problems by using same kind of thinking that we used when we created them. It's so true, it holds such a true statement even today in this situation. We need to build green, and sustainability is the only way forward for our lives to really transform and go back to the fundamentals. We always call it like we have the rich heritage, we have the tradition, we have to just remodel the tradition to suit the conditions that we have today. And that's exactly what the green building movement or the green building is concept is all about. Now, where do we start? How do we start implementing these concepts or these knowledges into our buildings is the question which is there in everyone's mind. And the right answer is to start with the basics itself. We have to combine nature, we have to combine passive elements with the systems that are there in place. We have to combine all the panchbhutas that was there and even there today. We have to use them to the best of our possibilities in the projects and combine it with the building design, because the potential, if you really see in this pyramid, this is the energy pyramid. The energy consumption to its maximum lies here, and if we integrate our passive measures right, there's a lot of potential of low cost strategies which can be implemented in the project, and you can save a lot of energy right there. It is after that becomes more feasible for you to implement the right technologies, the smart controls and everything in the building to make it more efficient. And the whole concept of net zero energy building can be implemented only if we follow this approach, because renewables make more sense. You have limited amount of area to put solar. If your energy consumption is more than the area available, is not going to make sense. So this is the approach that we have to use for our buildings when we are talking of efficient buildings or sustainable buildings. So that was the first step. How do we combine? The second is we already have got the right codes in place today. There has been a lot of effort in the industry to come out with the standards which can really be used by the industry people to make the building more sustainable. National Building Code of India has got the chapter on sustainability, approach to sustainability, which is quite handy and quite a ready reckoner for any one of you to really see what are the requirements that can be used in a building. We have got Energy Conservation Building Code. Now, Energy Conservation Building Code again lies out guidelines as in how, what kind of specification should we deal with in our buildings when it is about selecting the right material for walls, for glass, for the right kind of equipments, the selection of chillers, everything. It lays out the guidelines for that also. Indoor Environmental Quality Standard. With the growing concerns on the indoor air quality because of the outdoor pollutions, this is the first standard that we have in India, published by ISHRAE, which kind of gives guideline on how do we design our building so that we can tackle the problems of indoor environmental quality. So these are available and you should really use them. If you see the potential, now the benchmark for commercial buildings, if you see, this is the EPI, which is Energy Performance Index. So 140 units per square meter per year is the benchmark. If I simply comply with Energy Conservation Building Code, my building can be at least 30 to 35% better in terms of its energy consumption. After that, if I apply the right technologies, it can come down to 35 to 40 EPI also. And then it becomes more viable to add renewables and get to the net zero. So we have the potential, but it's just that we have to use the right direction to keep these things in our projects. As an engineer or as an architect, we always have to think for future. We have to design buildings for future. The building which is being constructed today has to be used for many more years to come. If we don't look at the trends which are going to come in the future, the buildings are not going to behave properly for that particular period. And the kind of trends we are looking at today in the buildings industry which is coming in, net zero energy buildings is definitely there, and we have the live examples in India today to look at those buildings. Healthy buildings. Now, beyond efficiency, it is the health aspect which is very important for people to, becoming more and more important in the buildings to really address. Occupant comfort, microclimate, how our outside areas are going to behave in terms of the temperatures or the conditions outside, which can impact even my indoor conditions. Outdoor comfort, with more and more developments which are large scale coming up, if we don't look at the aspect of outdoor comfort, it's not going to work. Building commissioning and operation and maintenance and integrated modeling. So these are the future trends that we have to really look at while we design the buildings today. Thermal comfort is also one aspect that is gaining attention and is very important to consider. A lot of us set temperatures in our air conditioned areas to be 22 degrees or 21 degrees, but it may not be required if we have the right kind of a building, we have the right kind of equipment. This is a fan which is, give you an example. This is called HVLS, high volume, low speed fan. What it does, that we have used it in our office also, and it helps us to reduce the air conditioning temperatures because it keeps on rotating with no noise, very low electricity consumption. It helps us to set the thermostat temperatures higher. So we don't need to go for 20, 21 degrees. We are setting it up at 27 degrees and people are still feeling comfortable. Energy use monitoring is also one important area which is, we have to keep a track of the energy consumption in all types of buildings. Indoor air quality, the kind of, air we breathing inside the building has to be filtered so that the pollutants which are critical today in almost all the metropolitan cities is a concern. We have to deal with that. Chilled beams, radiant cooling, these are new technologies which are coming, and there are live examples in India where you can see these and has to be considered in the designs. Underfloor air distribution. If you see this chart, energy use, in earlier days it used to be 20 watts per square feet. It is coming down drastically and the aim is to get to 4 watts per square feet. Dr. Jain also mentioned, this kind of a shift which has come is good for the industry and is something that we have to look at when we design our buildings. We don't have to design our building for this. We have to achieve these so that there is a balance in energy consumption, comfort and the whole environment. Apply integrated design approach. Gone are the days that when we used to design the buildings in separate disciplines, architect, engineering are going in separate department. It's more about integration. That is the need of the hour that we have to really apply to our buildings. And what we practice is Vikalp, wherein it is a systematic approach that has been defined, wherein right from the scope definition of a project, we take it to the site studies, We do the facade studies, optimize the layouts of the building, and then the lighting optimization. Then it comes to the mechanical, electrical design of the building, and that really takes you to the level of rating that you are expecting your building to achieve. A right design will always helps you to achieve the highest level of rating. A very important aspect that we have to look at while the designs are being done for the building, there are computer simulation tools available today. So instead of using thumb rule calculations, it's wise and it's really required that we take benefit of the tools which are available and do the, instead of guesstimates, let's have the quantified numbers to design the buildings in every sense. I'll show you some examples of that. Solar shading studies, wind analysis, energy simulations, daylight and glare, artificial, these are all types of simulations which are being used today. This is one of the presentations I'm just going to take you through in very brief sense. This is a hospital project where climate studies were done. Climate is the main, you know, basis of the whole design when we talk of the sustainable building. So you have to understand which climate are you designing the building for. What kind of passive strategies? This is a psychometric analysis done to identify how each hour of the year, which is represented by a dot in this chart, will behave when we apply different strategies. Right. Facade analysis, you know, the glare studies. Today, even in the glazed buildings, you know, people are not really able to use the daylight. We have 300 days of sun, but we are not using it properly just because the facade is not designed right. So if we design the facade right with no glare, people are going to welcome the daylight. So glare is a very important aspect in this particular country that we have. All this yellow patch that you see is a glare. By doing the right kind of shading devices or the strategies on that particular facade, we bring that glare down, and the compliant areas, which is comfortable daylight, are approximately for the whole floor that you get. So in a nutshell, what I want to convey is that it is the integration of everything, the natural elements, the systems that we have, that can really take us to the sustainability at a higher level, and that's what we should aim for in our projects. Thank you.